trains are awesome and we should build them in every city in America, right?
Chicago, D.C., London.
Unless you live in a big hero city that has trains, you are probably a dude who drives, because nobody wants to be a dud who is stuck riding the bus.
There's always been historically a perception that trains are cool and buses are dirty and stinky and slow.
A train station is like a binding contract. A smooth, speedy, spotless train will arrive. A bus stop is a flimsy roadside attraction.
When you're taking a bus, it's someplace on the side of the road and you're not quite sure, is somebody really going to come take care of me here?
One, two, three, four!
Imagine a world where Memphis had a subway, Albuquerque had an L train, and Columbus, Georgia, Lubbock, Texas, and Wichita, Kansas all had light rail.
And there's one reason why they don't. Trains are stupid expensive.
New rail transit lines cost over $100 million per mile. And if it's a subway, it can cost close to $1 billion a mile or more.
The biggest mistake we make is we knowingly underestimate the cost of these projects up front.
Versus a city bus, it gets to use the public roads for free. And that's why we suburbanites are stuck with them. Don't we deserve real transit? Something huge, like this project I watched my city build while I was in grad school.
Okay, so there's the old traffic pole. All the way over there is the new one. That's a big change to widen it that much.
Which pre-pandemic had 10,000 boardings per day, which is kind of crazy because it's all on a bus. A bus?
We had a bus that ran this route. It had about 1,800 to 2,000 boardings per day. In April, we were at about 9,800 average weekday boardings.
I'm talking with Mary Delamare-Schaefer. Her agency recently opened a long-awaited transit line. Utah County, Utah wanted to connect its two commuter rail stations with two universities.
So the Utah Valley Express is a wonderful service. We have 18 different platforms, built structure, just like light rail. So you know the bus is going to come there. So during our peak hours in the morning and the afternoon, it's every 6 minutes. During the day, it's every 10 minutes. If you ride Utah Valley Express, you're probably not going to ever look at a schedule. You're going to just hop on the next bus.
This train-like frequency lets operators break the old bus driver creed. Try not to be late, but never, ever pull away from a bus stop early.
You have to change your thinking as a bus operator, mostly to think about pacing. It's like a train rather than stopping and waiting for your hold point.
The goal is to make the Utah Valley Express light rail on tires.
I've ridden with students from Utah Valley University. They're right in the middle of the day. I'm like, what are you doing? They're like, well, I'm going to go home for lunch. Because the bus comes so often that I can go home, have lunch, hop back on, get back to the university.
As good as it is still a bus.
It's a lot bumpier than a light rail train because you're going over asphalt. Sound.
If money was no issue, this community would have built light rail. But Utah County, Utah is kind of small. And the people there are very, very, very frugal.
This was a $200 million project. So that's nothing small. And it's a third the cost of what it costs to put rails in.
The light rail, you know, looks very fancy, but it's really a perception, I think, that it's better rather than a reality.
Buses haven't been afforded the same level of priority.
I'm Victoria Perk.
Jennifer Flynn.
I'm the director of the Transit Research Program at the Center for Urban Transportation Research at the University of South Florida in Tampa.
I'm a senior research associate working in the National Bus Rapid Transit Institute.
Victoria, Jennifer, and their colleagues research innovative ways cities can fix their traffic problems, including this half-century-old technology. After the war, the United Kingdom was busy. They were rebuilding and they authorized construction of new towns to move 500,000 people out of the slums into quality living spaces. Now, one of these was Runcorn, a new town near Liverpool. It offered shopping and green space, industrial areas, all for 30,000 new people. More people than the little British roadways could handle, but too few to support a new subway or even a tram railroad. So the town's planners cheated. Oh, they built a 13-mile-long tram, but it used asphalt instead of rails and buses instead of trains. And then they left pretty much everything else the same. So all these fake trains rolled down fake train tracks, roads just for buses. So traffic could never slow a bus down. And that let Runcorn keep train quality clockwork with buses arriving every 7 minutes on the dot. And the results certainly were not fake. Nearly one-third of trips in Runcorn were on the busway. And it was a huge bargain considering the entire system only cost £3 million. In today's money, that'd be about $5 million per mile. Of course, the Runcorn system has an advantage. The town's planners bragged to an industry magazine in 1971 about the city's unique design. Everyone lives within 1/4 mile of a busway station, which makes it just about as convenient as going by car. The world's first ever bus rapid transit system was a smashing success. Major cities in Brazil, Canada, Colombia, and Nigeria were among some of the first to try and duplicate Runcorn's success. And they did. Especially bus rapid transit in South America. Bogota sees 2 million passengers per year. Wait, what's that? Oh, sorry. 2 million passengers per day. One of our first opportunities for BRT popped up in LA during the 1990s, with all the animated drama you'd expect from the entertainment capital of the world.
Welcome to the Orange Line.
Where's Jose?
Probably stuck in traffic.
I'm coming. Wait for me.
Jose! Don't do it!
Ignored the warning signs.
So the Orange Line was supposed to be light rail. It was going to run down the old Pacific Electric Red Line, a train that got torn out in the 1950s. It was a good design, and it had one problem.
A nearby state senator who thought trains were too noisy or something. So he shoved through a law in 1991 that says all new rail projects in the San Fernando Valley must be in a tunnel. That's stupid expensive. But the law didn't say anything about buses having to travel in a tunnel. LA Metro hoped that maybe, perhaps, in the distant year of 2020, they might see 20,000 boardings each day. Well, Metro didn't have to wait that long.
They said, wow, you know, we attracted our ridership. We achieved it in 3-4 years.
It's no transmillennio, but for the United States, they'd built a successful bus rapid transit line.
The definition of BRT is fuzzy. You know, it's not like light rail, where, you know, most people know what we're talking about.
That's partly due to the huge shopping list that light rail requires. You have to put in a platform. You have to install signals and crossing gates.
And you have to construct new railroad track for every inch of the project.
But with bus rapid transit, the only thing you have to have is a bus.
BRT kind of allows you to have this very flexible, almost like a toolkit. You can kind of customize them into different packages. They don't have to be implemented all at once. You can do some things up front with plans for later on.
Los Angeles has deep pockets, so it's really easy for them to buy all the goodies, all the upgrades, everything they need to do to effectively turn the Orange Line into light rail on rubber tires. But out of the 50 bus rapid transit systems in America, only 10 have their own dedicated busway. So what about those other 40 systems?
BRT Customization Package 1, keeping buses out of traffic jams. Okay, so you might not be able to afford a busway.
The midway might be, you know, like a median bus lane, repurposing some of the roadway for transit only.
Painting that lane so it really did make it stand out.
That may be an easy sale when you have lots of space and you can tell the public, we're adding a brand new extra lane just for buses. It becomes a bit more controversial when you have to say, sorry, we're repurposing one of your existing car lanes just for buses.
Bus-only lanes now in effect. Can we go and check them out?
You might find the only feasible option is to send buses back into the traffic. You just got to make sure they don't get caught in jams.
They do use queue jumps. It's kind of like a little cutout of the lane, and it allows the bus to veer off to the side and then pass everyone.
Two researchers at Florida International University found queue jumps give a bus a speed boost between 3 and 17%.
This is great for smaller cities like Madison, Wisconsin, who are implementing BRT over time.
Hoping to get the entire bus rapid transit system up and running by 2024, this was just step one.
Package two, getting people on buses fast.
Bus rapid transit is a platform. It sits higher. The bus's floor sits lower, which means no stairs to climb. People can just enter at level. And that's great if somebody's in a wheelchair. They can just roll straight on.
Less time for passengers to board and more time for the bus to be in motion. When it's too expensive to build a full train station-like platform, planners could dial it back a notch and build a quality bus stop. But make sure you keep the kiosks. That way passengers can buy their ticket before the bus arrives, just like they would a train ticket. And that way they can board using any door, not just the front one, since there's no more making everybody wait as you dump quarters into the fare box. The real magic is in the traffic signal computers, which can detect a bus approaching. Specialized detectors can see a bus coming down the road. To learn about similar loops and camera detectors for cars, check out my link above.
Pull out the back end of the camera.
Travel times, I think, on average improved by 35%, I think, in some of the early studies they did. They determined that most of that was coming from the transit signal priority.
This helps offset time the bus stops at stations and makes travel time competitive with driving, sometimes maybe even better. I tried racing one.
Side by side a bus is kind of weird. He gets to stop for the passengers there. Now I think we leave the bus in the dust. The bus is catching up with me again. Well, that's fine. It makes for a more interesting video. I honestly thought I was gonna film a video where I'd blow the doors off the bus after the first stop, would never see it again.
Transit signal priority must be like a guitar. Keeping everyone moving is like Van Halen's sheet music. Not everyone can play it, but in the hands of a skillful traffic engineer, tapping two lanes with only one traffic signal, it just plain rocks.
So fiddling with the traffic signals provides most of BRT's time-saving benefit. A lot of cities may ask themselves, why are we bothering to spend the money on all the other stuff?
Don't just add a couple of features and call it BRT.
When local officials are faced with limited resources, there can be a temptation to use the flexibility of BRT as cost-cutting measure.
If the dedicated lane is gone and the queue jumps are gone and there's no signal priority, people have to still climb stairs to board and the bus is blocking traffic, you might only have a fancy-looking bus stop along a very regular bus route.
There are many systems that call themselves BRT and maybe really aren't BRT. They may have a couple of the features, but not enough that's really adequate.
They were promised great things and just left with some basic upgrades to bus service. Over-promised, under-delivered, and the community ends up feeling duped.
Okay, I do not want this to turn into a BRT debate.
I feel like we're being, I don't want to say bullied.
This is socialism, and it's not going to happen.
A dramatic increase in transients and criminals.
A vote for Robert Dyer is a vote to kill BRT.
If you want to have some enhanced bus service, then call it something else.
Don't get enamored because our system is shiny and working. There was a lot of planning that went into this to make this happen. Don't get stuck on a mode. Think about what your goal is and grow yourself into transit. And also you have to think about the goal. Are you really after ridership? Or are you after coverage? Or are you after both?
And don't forget about maintenance. Maybe the cost of maintaining them and the need to maintain them. You plant all these great things and they grow and then they grow way too much. If damage happens at a station, fix it and take care of it right away.
So I suppose it's time to answer the billion-dollar question. Is a bus rapid transit system as good as a light rail system? And I think it comes down to two factors. One, did the transit agency that built it put in the love and care and investment into the bus rapid transit system like they would have if this had been a light rail system? Second, do you consider this a stinky, smelly bus, or would you actually ride this thing? Now, I can't speak for you, but I've got ridership data here that will tell us a little bit about what it was like. Now, it's all pre-pandemic. It's from February. That UVX system in Utah that we talked about at the top of the video, it has about 12,000 riders per day on an 11-mile system that comes out to about 1,100 people per mile. The Trax Light rail system that's also in Utah, one county north of UVX, it has 56,000 people pre-pandemic per day on a 45-mile system, coming out to about 1,250 people per mile. So that's about a 13% drop from light rail to the bus rapid transit. Now looking at LA Metro's Orange Line, it has about 22, a little over 1,000 people on an 18-mile system, coming out to about 1,200 people per mile, versus the Gold Line Light Rail, that's a 31-mile system, has just shy of about 48,000. It's about a 20% drop from the Gold Line to the Orange Line bus rapid transit. When you consider these systems cost one-third the price of light rail, I can see a lot of transit agencies starting to seriously consider investing in a good bus rapid transit system.
Thank you to Victoria Perk and Jennifer Flynn of the Center for Urban Transportation Research, Mary Delamare-Schaefer of the Utah Transit Authority, and you for subscribing to and supporting this channel. Let's answer more transportation questions together.